Welcome everyone. We are delighted to welcome you to a new edition of Critical Humanities, our Critical Humanities series. Today, we are particularly privileged in welcoming Venugopal Madipatti, who's an architectural historian, teaching in the School of Design in Ambedkar University. So Venugopal or Venu recently published Gandhi and Architecture, A Time for Low-Cost Housing from Routledge. And he is the co-editor of another book, which has also come out recently, The Materiality of Liquescence, The Water Histories of South Asia. He's currently writing a book on ecological aesthetics and the social imaginary in South Asia. This book is centered around the theme of mimesis. And we are particularly proud to report that Venu actually began his academic employment in India at CSDS. So welcome home, Venu. So I recently read a good part of Gandhi and Architecture, which really talks about a number of things. I mean, the Gandhi and Architecture, what is remarkable about this book is the productive aporias that Venu brings in this book. And what are these aporias? Materiality and the disavowal of Gandhi's body, the ambiguities of space, the certitudes of built form, and finally, the elusive nature of what has been characterized as vernacular architecture in post-independence India. What really strikes the reader is this collision of different forms of knowledges. It's a very dramatic collision and a beautifully crafted collision that Venu brings to bear in this book. And what are these? Gandhi's own political aesthetic struggles, the history of science and numbers, and the mundane microecologies of materials, brick, clay, cement. Over to you, Venu.
Thank you, Ravi. Hi, everybody. And I just wanted to thank my friends and my mentors at CSDS, and it's good to see Professor Nandi, Shail, Ravi, Ravikant, and Hilal Bhai, all of you. Thank you so much for having me over. And I think I'll start without much ado. I'll actually just share my screen because it's a PowerPoint presentation. So one second. Share screen. So I trust you're able to see the screen. Can you see the screen? Okay, so I'll start. All right, so hello everybody and thank you. And I'll be speaking today about Gandhi and space. And some of the arguments I present today are from the currents that inform a book that I published recently titled Gandhi and Architecture, A Time for Low-Cost Housing. And I felt it would be appropriate to provide some kind of a background conceptual note to help draw attention to the contours of that book project, which took almost a decade to complete. And so this talk really is a way of entering into a prehistory of that book, albeit a prehistory written in a retrospective sense, right? And so also the categories I'm particularly interested in are space, nothingness, and weak thought. And also, as you will see eventually in this presentation, low-cost housing. So what I'll do is I'll begin by reading out an excerpt from a text titled Akash that Gandhi wrote in 1942 while he was in prison in the Aga Khan Palace as a part of a larger volume called Key to Health. So this is a cover of Key to Health. It's really, it's quite an extraordinary cover. And it's not the only cover. I mean, there's a Hindi cover as well. They were sort of known as the Arogya Ki Kunji. And so this is actually the section which I'm interested in, which is in Hindi, but I'm looking at an English translation as well. So I just start reading out this particular section on Akash, because I think this text has a bearing on the kinds of questions that we'll be raising over the course of this presentation. So I'm actually going to just try and read this out. It's quite a long, dreary text, but it's got some very interesting moments within it. So if you'll bear with me. So on a clear day, on looking up, one sees a beautiful mauve blue canopy, which is known as Akash or sky. So far as we are concerned, this sky or the ether is limitless. So the first lesson to be learnt is this, that we should not put any partitions between ourselves and the sky, which is the infinite, which is very near and yet very far away. If our bodies could be in contact with the sky without the intervention of houses, roofs, and even clothes, we are likely to enjoy the maximum amount of health. And so to the extent that we are able to approach this state in practice, we will enjoy contentment and peace of mind. Many households are so packed with all sorts of unnecessary decorations and furniture, which one can very well do without, that a simple living man, and this is mostly a man he's talking about, will feel suffocated in those surroundings. They are nothing but means of harboring dust, bacteria, and insects. So here in the house where I'm under detention, I feel quite lost. The heavy furniture, chairs, tables, sofas, bedsteads, innumerable looking glasses all get on my nerves. My desire, and this is an important word, my desire to be in tune with the infinite has saved me from many complications in life. In a nutshell, and in the language of the subject under consideration, under discussion, I have gone on creating more and more contact with Akash. And so with the increase in contact with Akash went improvement in health. I had more contentment and peace of mind, and the desire for belongings almost disappeared. Now, this is an important portion of this text. This train of thought taken to the extreme leads us to a condition when even the body becomes an obstacle separating man, again man, from the infinite. To understand this truth is to become indifferent to the dissolution of the body, for to lose oneself in the infinite is to find oneself. So I'll come to this section, but I think what I'll do is I'll actually start with my response to this text. And so I'll start, right? So of all the artifacts related to Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi's life, his body is perhaps the least amenable to being historicized. And this is not necessarily because of the absence of an adequate archival record to help scholars historicize Gandhi's body. In fact, if anything at all, the archive attests to how Gandhi thought almost obsessively about his own body. And so if it isn't the endlessly extended records of his experiments with eating fruits and fasting in turn of the century South Africa, it is Gandhi's inordinately profuse writing about celibacy and its difficult anatomical entailments through the 1930s that serves to remind us that Gandhiism, even at its most overwhelmingly cerebral, starkly supervened on the material or on the corporeal. So in other words, suspend the existence of Gandhi's body as a material entity, and there would be very little left to reckon with in Gandhian idealism, Gandhian thought, or in Gandhian politics. Just to sort of give you a quick sense of a few images that you'd associate with Gandhi's body. And yet, against the grain of such a positive determination of Gandhi's body as the material locus for the emergence of Gandhian idealism, there also is the curious case of Gandhi's body as a negative entity. The paradox is that there are instances when the very existence of Gandhi's body may have been predicated on the determinate negation of all predicative activity. There is, in other words, a story to tell about Gandhi's body as a conspicuous renunciation of all materiality in the 1930s and 40s, especially towards the latter portions of his career as a nonviolent revolutionary. But how is one to tell this story? If indeed Gandhi's body was not so much a thing itself, but an entity engulfed by and perhaps even wholly suffused with nothingness, how is one to disinter it? How, in short, is one to retrieve a body that is, to put it mildly, space itself? Moreover, what are the architectural and political entailments of foregrounding Gandhi's occasional allusions to the dissolution of his body into nothingness in late colonial India? Perhaps some answers to such questions can be sought in Gandhi's 1942 essay titled Akash. For his own part, Gandhi had penned this essay as a part of a larger volume titled Key to Health while he was imprisoned in the Aga Khan Palace following the launch of the Quit India movement. So this is the Aga Khan Palace, 1940s images. So this is a more contemporary image of it. Now, already a decade earlier, that's a decade before 1942, Gandhi had written about Akash to his nephew Narandas while he was imprisoned in the Yerawada jail. So if he returned then to contemplating Akash in the Aga Khan Palace in 1942, Gandhi did so because he, by his own admission, once again had the time to do so. So as he mentioned in his introduction to Key to Health, the present enforced rest offers me such an opportunity and I'm taking advantage of it. More pertinently, Gandhi confided in his introduction to Key to Health that anyone who observes the rules of health mentioned in this book will find that he, it's again mostly him, has gotten it a real key to unlock the gates leading him to health. He will not need to knock at the doors of doctors or vaidyas from day to day. So in response, we can say at the very least then when Gandhi wrote about Akash or the sky at the Aga Khan Palace in 1942, he did so because he was concerned about the bodily health of his followers, mostly male followers. The freeing up of the body from its vestments led, as Gandhi observed in Akash, to the enjoyment of the maximum amount of health. And so if on the one hand, an increase in material possessions such as heavy furniture, chairs, tables, sofas, bedsteads, and innumerable looking glasses engendered feelings of suffocation, on the other hand, decreasing material possessions and therefore becoming more exposed to the infinitely extended element Akash saved one from the complications of life. In short, the more one increased contact between oneself and the infinite ethereal nothingness or the infinite cessation of all predicative activity called Akash, the more peaceful and serene one became in a bodily sense. And so in a nutshell, the text Akash was all about bodily health, right? And yet, notwithstanding such an immediate interpretation of Akash as a text devoted to an infinite ethereal nothingness and the bodily health that came through a communion with it, weaker thoughts arise at a second remove and subsequent readings. Going beyond merely engaging with the diminution of architecture and clothes as a means towards establishing the existence of an infinite ether that was nothing at all, one also begins to discern how in Akash, the relegation of clothes and architecture into the background, or more specifically the negation of clothes and architecture, may have served to mark or inaugurate the body as a more immediate relevant foreground. Gandhi's body, one could argue, did not so much pre-exist the retrenchment of architecture and clothes in his imagination. Rather, it was the very act of explicitly diminishing or decentering the value of architecture and clothes, that is their determinate negation, that raised the curtain in the first instance on the body as a center or as a site of Gandhian helpful practice. Such a weak second reading of Akash is certainly of a piece with the larger arc of Gandhi's political attempts at enhancing the visibility of his own body. In this regard, we could turn towards the anthropologist Joseph Alter's now classic Gandhi's Body, Sex, Diet, and the Politics of Nationalism to learn more about Gandhi's attempts at consciously emplacing his own body with its proclivities and desires at the hub of his efforts at bringing about social and political change in late imperial India. And so as Alter observes, while working towards reform on a national scale, Gandhi often delineated the problem of action in terms of a discrete microphysics of self-discipline required of those involved. So even when writing about national and international events, Gandhi seems to have preoccupied himself with his embodied subjectivity in the context of dramatic social-political change. And so rather than arriving at Gandhi from the vantages of his ideas, which could be divested of their material basis, one could, as Alter suggests, begin with the microphysics of self-discipline of Gandhi's incarnate material self. In other words, one could begin with Gandhi's emphasis on his own visible body as a material locus of struggles to make better sense of his Indian nationalist project. Now, what then in the light of Alter's writing about Gandhi are the prospects for writing histories of architecture as a weak, faintly discernible, decentered artifact in Gandhi's imagination? Should one explore the manner in which architecture itself may have emerged as a kind of a marginalized or negated phenomenon in Gandhi's imagination, or as a phenomenon that he forcefully relegated to the marginal spaces of domesticity and interiority in the favor of foregrounding his more pressing centralized concerns about his own public presence as a body? So what we're looking at is the emergence of the protagonicity of Gandhi's body or the protagonicity of community and public life, right? So is that how we sort of approach architecture and its marginalization? Or on the contrary, should we engage with the manner in which architecture could in and of itself have belonged within Gandhi's weaker thoughts? So Putting it differently, should one engage with architecture as a marginal or a negated site, where the more well-established, stable, semantic, and semiological systems and fixities of Gandhi's thinking became weakened over time? Now, notwithstanding the urgency of such questions about the determinate negation of architecture in Gandhi's imagination, we also have to contend with the sheer velocity of Gandhian negations, right? And so successive waves of negation in Akash, for instance, in the text title Akash, for instance, serve to divest the body itself from its centrality in Gandhi's writing. So the tragedy or even the paradox is that Gandhi's limited finite body, which initially achieves its protagonicity in his writing through a conspicuous negation of architecture and clothes, is itself subsequently forfeited in the favor of foregrounding a new protagonist, that is, an infinitely extended Akash or nothingness, right? Because Gandhi writes in Akash, this train of thought, so if you, I'm just saying like, what you're seeing is like the emergence of the body as a kind of a protagonist in this narrative, and this is kind of eventually supplanted by Akash, or this infinite ether that becomes this kind of new protagonist, right? So as he says, this train of thought taken to the extreme leads us to the condition, this is from Akash, this train of thought taken to the extreme leads us to a condition where even when even the body becomes an obstacle separating man, again, male, from the infinite. To understand this truth is to become indifferent to the dissolution of the body, for to lose oneself in the infinite is to find oneself. So again, the infinite is now anointed as a new sovereign at the center, right? And what is dissolved or rendered weak and ineffectual is what was formerly the sovereign, that is Gandhi's body. So much then for architecture's weak thought. We now bear witness to the superfluity of the body itself. Indeed, so smoothly has the body been cast aside or weakened in the favor of strengthening a more agreeable protagonist, that is Akash or the infinite. So what then to make of Gandhi's, I mean, keeping all of these negations in mind, what then to make of Gandhi's rapidly escalating desire for a worthier protagonist, or even his desire for a loftier, more limitless, infinite foreground, such as Akash? What is one to make of the transvaluation of Gandhi's desire to leave behind architecture into a desire to leave behind his own body? What indeed to make of Gandhi's hankering after leaving behind more broadly, right? How do we understand this phenomenon of Gandhi's tendency to leave behind, or at least his desire to leave behind? Now, as disappointing as it might sound, an examination of the architecture of Gandhi's residences dating to the mid-1930s in the village of Segaon or Shegaon in Wardha brings one no closer to answering the aforementioned questions. Instead, an examination of those residences, which were built between 1936 and 37, only serves to heighten one's sense of puzzlement. Those residences in Shegaon, known today as Adi Nivas and Bapu Kuti, have their own peculiar story to tell. So this is Adi Nivas and this is Bapu Kuti. Now, Adi Nivas and Bapu Kuti were designed by Gandhi's follower, the British spiritualist Madeleine Slade, who's also known as Mirabai. And so this is an image of her. Her autobiography is The Spirit's Pilgrimage. I highly recommend people read that text. So in July 1936, when the then hexagenarian Gandhi shifted to Shegaon to personally oversee constructive village improvement work, he initially stayed in Adi Nivas, right? And so Slade actually, Mirabai actually makes this house for him. So the Gandhi archive dating to the time provides some evidence related to the construction of that structure. Gandhi apparently, I mean, if you look at the archive, ordained that the construction of that hut was to not exceed rupees 100. Moreover, Gandhi forsook the expense of having partitions made within his hut, even as he asserted his need for a bare, indispensable minimum dwelling. So this question of what is a minimum dwelling itself is quite a significant one, actually, in housing discourse. When we come to this question of minimum standards, but I'm not talking about that, but Gandhi has a sense of a so-called minimum standard, right? And so, but that being said, he still wants the budget of the hut to stay below 100 rupees. And there's a letter that he writes to Jamnalal Bajaj about this, which is there in the archive, right? So the architecture of Adi Nivas, or what was to become Adi Nivas later, in that sense was a parsimonious one. Now, but you also sort of take a look at what's the interior of Adi Nivas. It's mostly an unpartitioned plan. It's like a single room, right? It has some attachments, but it's really a single continuous space. Now, Unlike the unpartitioned plan of Adinivas, the plan of Bapukutty is a far more elaborate one. So this is Bapukutty from the outside, but you actually look inside, it's actually a partitioned plan, right? There's quite a few different rooms and functions over here. So so in late 1936, when Gandhi's health deteriorated, Slade, or Mirabai, refashioned a nearby hut that she'd built for herself to accommodate him. And this second hut, Bapukutty, was, as Slade claimed in her autobiography, The Spirit's Pilgrimage, a proper cottage for Bapu. So at a plinth area of roughly 80 square meters, this proper cottage was not particularly large. However, in spite of the relative meagerness of its size, when one peers into a 1954 construction drawing of that structure, one notes the generosity with which Slade had allocated functions inside its enclosed walls, right? So within the confines of Bapukutty's thick exterior mud walls, as essayed in this 1954 plan, one finds, among other functions, there's a veranda, there's a living room. This whole area is a living room. There's a storeroom, there's a lavatory, there is a massage room. And the living room also is kind of divided up into these sections. So one of these is the spaces of Mahadev Desai, who would be taking notes at the time. So this is the sort of very elaborate plan that you're seeing now. But setting aside this elaborate architecture of Bapukutty for the time being, let us pay attention to Gandhi's own activities in Wardha or in Shegaon, dating to the late colonial period. So as it turns out, the Gandhi who stayed in Shegaon in the mid-1930s may not have been entirely unlike the person who wrote Akash nearly 7 years later in the Aga Khan Palace. So in this regard, I interviewed two Gandhians in Wardha. I interviewed Dr. Vibha Gupta, who runs the Magan Sangrahale, and the late Thakur Das Bang, Professor Thakur Das Bang. And so this is actually an interior view of Bapukutty. I mean, it's a very popular image, so I'm just sort of giving you a general sense of it. And so this is Professor Thakur Das Bang. He's no more. And both Professor Dr. Vibha Gupta and Professor Bang spoke about the outdoors. So while Dr. Gupta drew from what she'd heard from Gandhians since childhood to suggest that Gandhi was like a soldier who mostly lived outside his huts, Professor Bang, who stayed at that time in Shegaon, suggested gently that I should not be studying the interior architecture of Gandhi's huts at all. Rather, and he was himself staying in one of those huts. Rather, I should be studying the whole of the environment outside. So this was a very puzzling thing, and this happened in 2005. This is a photograph dating to 2005, and I think it took me a long time to actually begin to comprehend or even begin to speculate about how does one understand this idea of the whole. So now, whatever else Bapukutty may have been then in terms of its interior arrangements, we must pay heed to the task of imagining it in a negative sense. That is, as a limited or finite place to be relinquished in the favor of an infinite Akash or a limitless universe or a whole, right? Something that's much larger than this finite bounded entity called Bapukutty. So insofar as one stays loyal to Dr. Gupta and Professor Bang's narrations, one cannot entirely envisage Bapukutty independent of its relation to Gandhi's periodic withdrawals from it. In other words, remove the Gandhian's allusions to Gandhi's withdrawal from the architecture of Shegaon in the mid-1930s, and one is left devoid of a noble Gandhian way of experiencing that way architecture, which is to say that the only way in which one can actually begin to even bring that kind of architecture into discourse is to actually pay heed to what is being said about it. And what is being said about it is that it has to be left behind. So how does one begin to actually understand architecture not so much as that which must be inhabited, but is that which must be left behind, right? And this kind of a complete reversal of our understanding of the way in which we approach architecture, understanding architecture is something that gets weakened and that doesn't have such a strong grip or hold on us as much as it's a tenuous grip, which can be sort of let go of. That's the kind of challenge in imagining architecture in the reverse, right? And that's what initially was the kind of question which I think, I felt could have been the starting point of the book, but as you'll see, that is not what actually happened. As the presentation, I'm also suggesting that maybe perhaps we're getting a bit ahead of ourselves here. At this stage, we will do well to remember that Gandhi is principally not a proponent of infinitude, which is, Akash or the open, but rather of finitude, right? He may have written about Akash, but we do know that Gandhi is somebody who is only too well known to us as a conservative proponent of a self-sacrificial staying in one's own proper place within the limits that are accorded to oneself, right? Or so we could also surmise in an architectural sense, of course, with some trepidation, were we to arrive at the architecture of Shegaon not so much from the vantages of Gandhi's desire to negate this architecture in the favor of an infinite Akash, but from the auspices of its construction expenditure. There was, as I mentioned earlier, an upper limit, a finite point, right, finitude, when it came to spending for what eventually came to be known as Adinivas. And so much of the discourse surrounding the construction of that hut, which is Adinivas, much of the discourse surrounding the construction of that hut in the Gandhi archive, as it turns out, relates to his foregoing living arrangements that he desired so as to stay strictly within the limits of a rupees 100 budget, right? So in fact, if the archive is to be believed, the story of Gandhi's stay in Shegaon is principally about his foregoing the desire to leave the village so as to stay within it at a considerable cost to his own well-being. So if you actually see the archive from 1936, I mean, if you like, I've spent so many years reading that particular year, and those 2 years actually, 1935 and 36, it's all about like finding the, you know, the will to stay in this place. He's falling ill, he contracts malaria, he has a nervous breakdown, but it's like this kind of fierce need to actually stay and not to sort of give in the desire to leave, right? So there's something to be said then about staying confined within the bounds of Adinivas and Bapu Kuti and exploring Gandhi's renunciation of his own desire, right? What then is this interior finite world of Adinivas and Bapu Kuti that at once is less than what Gandhi may have desired from his lodgings and at the same time more than the mere result of a balancing act of construction expenditure? How does one write about a finite architectural world of renunciation and sacrifice, even as this architectural world ceaselessly awaits its own eventual negation so as to reach for an infinite Akash, right? Now, to compound such questions about finitude, there also is the matter of Gandhi's advocacy of Varnashrama Dharma closer to the time of the creation of these low-cost huts. As mentioned earlier, Adinivas was built in July 1936, when the then hexagenarian Gandhi shifted to Shegaon to personally oversee constructive village improvement work, right? And this is a short while after Dr. Ambedkar published his speech for the Jatpat Todak Mandal, the annihilation of caste. So and there's also, if you actually look at the archive, you'll find considerable correspondence between them, not considerable, but a significant amount in the 1935 and 36. It's also regarding the abandonment of a certain village called Kavitha. So there is communication between them. And what you also see is that the archive is fairly clear in this matter. In addition, there are also references to Varnashrama Dharma. Gandhi is referring to Varna. So self-sacrificially staying within the bounds of one's Varna, one learns from the Gandhi archival record, the Gandhian archival record dating to 1935, is in keeping with the Kshatriya desire for self-sacrifice. So this is roughly also the time when Gandhi was advocating village improvement and advising village workers to not run away from the villagers and to stay, again, the emphasis on staying, within a short distance of the village. So the sense of boundedness and staying within limits animates virtually all of Gandhi's thinking at this time. And it's also the case that this language of staying is also tied in his discourse, at least partially with the emphasis on Varna. So the most significant thing we're looking at for the better part is one of finitude. And this does also raise the question, to what extent is Gandhi, and I'm sort of taking it back to the text, which is an Akash, to what extent is Gandhi also hampered by the idea of sacrifice when it comes to thinking about the infinite? Where, for instance, in Gandhi's imagination does the infinite actually stay? I mean, if you're talking about staying, right? I mean, the question is also that the infinite itself has a place of its own, right? What is this proper place of the infinite? So, and I think if you actually read the text, symptomatically you get the sense that he's not able to think about the infinite in a positive sense. Rather, even the infinite can only be thought as a kind of a negation of a desire to leave one's place, right? So the infinite is also the outcome of the negation of some being's desire to leave its place, which is the kind of a paradoxical thing that you start seeing, that here's a thinker who's actually trying to think about the infinite, but at the same time, he is principally a thinker of finitude, right? And sort of which leads to the question, perhaps Gandhi never did have a positive conception of the infinite. Rather, even the infinite may have been constituted self-sacrificially, although this is more along the lines of speculation, I'm saying, because I think we'll have to read the text symptomatically to get a sense of, you know, where he's going with it. And so it is finitude then that I kind of write about in this book on Gandhi and architecture. And so I just want to come closer to the end over here, just to say that this book, as sort of its blurb would suggest, chronicles the emergence of a low-cost, low-rise housing architecture that conforms to Gandhi's religious need to establish finite boundaries for everyday actions. And finitude in turn defines Gandhi's conservative conception of religion. Furthermore, the book also explores the afterlife of Gandhi and finitude after Gandhi's death in post-colonial India. And the necessity of such an architecture of finitude, as the book tries to show, is continually reimagined, right? And so, for instance, in the early 1950s era of mass housing for post-partition refugees from Pakistan, the making of a low-cost housing architecture was premised on the necessity of responding to economic concerns and to an emerging demographic mandate. In the 1970s, during the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries crisis, it was premised on the rise of urban and climatological necessities, right? And more recently, in the late 1990s and early 2000s, the reception of a Gandhian low-cost housing architecture of finitude, its reception has been premised on the emergence of language-based identitarianism in Wardha in Maharashtra, right? So each of these moments of necessity, as the book tries to show, reveals the enduring present of a Gandhian low-cost housing architecture of finitude, and also the need to emancipate Gandhian finitude from Gandhi's own exclusions, which are quite considerable, especially with his adherence to Varnashram Dharma. And I think a lot of the impact of that you actually begin to see in the writing of Madeline Slade, in the manner in which she's actually forced to stay away from the village. We'll talk about that later. But for my part, I wanted to mention that I was initially introduced to the idea of an architecture of finitude, or an architecture that entails foregoing desire and ambition in, of all places, the School of Planning and Architecture in Delhi, where in the mid-1990s, as a student, I did witness the architect Charles Correa, and he sort of came to our university, and he made this big dramatic demonstration of the sagacity of pursuing low-rise, medium to high-density housing in India, by magisterially collapsing this model of a skyscraper in his presentation, right? So he actually literally did this in our open air theater at that time, whatever was there at that time. He just he just swept this building away and he just showed it collapse, right? And so he sort of, and he said that this building is probably better actually when it's fallen down, because the fallen down world, is the world that actually is worth dwelling in, right? So I write about this collapse, right, in the preface of this book. And so it's through this collapse that Correa appeared to suggest that there must be limits to our ambitions, or some kind of a sacrificing of our sense of ambition to stack building blocks upon one upon the other. And so it's this image of Correa's sense of finitude, his rendition of a collapsed world of low-rise, medium to high-density housing, or more specifically, a world of limited or finite ambition in terms of height, that stayed with me, right? And so this world of limited ambition, this finite world of low-rise housing, was, in Correa's estimate, as I later came to learn, an exact urban analog of Gandhi's village utopia. So these are his words, right? So in fact, this image of Correa's collapsed world became the central metaphor for the book that I've actually written. Now, finally, I just also wanted to end by mentioning the theme of temporality, which is also in many ways undercut with the comprehension of finitude. And so at least as you actually look through the contours of the book, you see that there is this identification of history writing as a process that begins beyond the limits of the life of Gandhism, right? And therefore, history writing perhaps is not the most adequately suited temporal framework to examine Gandhism. And why? It's because history writing only begins when the present comes to an end, right? So it's only when Gandhism belongs in the past, which means when it's come to an end, which means when the present has been negated, that one can begin to historicize it, right? So you're really almost like stepping out of the household and into the infinite to be able to write about the household as much as write about Gandhism as a kind of a present, right? So so history writing itself in a certain sense constitutes a desire to go beyond the limits of the present and to be able to sort of look at the present as the past, to be able to step out of the present, to be able to gain that kind of distance, right? And so the temporality of this book, or the technique that I invest in heavily in one of it, is one of presentism, right? And that is to write about the past as a kind of present without stepping outside that present. So, I mean, of course, it's impossible, but it's an ambition, if you will. And I do not negate the present time at all, which is I try not to. Or I try not to think retrospectively about the present in the past tense. And so the key idea here is to consistently pursue the idea of a Gandhian low-cost housing architecture of finitude, principally as a kind of a present, you know, the present of Gandhian low-cost housing architecture of finitude. And we can't, the idea is to pursue it and to think about it in keeping with Gandhi's incapacity to think beyond limits as a historical object, right? To not approach it as a historical object, but to think about it in the present tense. And to this end, I principally draw from the archive in Wardha, in which, interestingly enough, in the 1970s, and this is where I'll end, Gandhism exists, or existed, I guess, in the present tense and in the past tense simultaneously. Because what was happening was, as I was kind of trying to look at the, this is where it actually began, when I was actually looking at the archive of the Center of Science for Villages, you'd find articles in the journal, which is the CSV's journal, Science for Villages. You'd find articles which were written by Kumarappa, Joseph Cornelius Kumarappa, who's a follower of Gandhi, in the present tense, which is to say that it's literally as if Kumarappa is writing those articles. And then you also have, in the same journal, a segment called From the Archives, where there's an article by Kumarappa. So to that extent, I think that's where this interest also in this idea of presentism came up. That at what point in time does Gandhism actually become something that belongs to the past in Wardha? Right? And so to that extent, I think this idea of presentism became a kind of a recurring question also in the writing of the idea of, you know, let's say a history. If at all it is possible to think about, you know, Gandhian low-rise housing as a historical entity, or if one is to sort of not really step beyond the limits of the present to actually think about it as history and to just simply write about it in the present tense. I think that's where I will end this presentation. And I'd be happy to take questions. The audio is not. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
We've heard you. And it was really stimulating, and I think I would like to, you know, before I go on to the floor, I think this, what you're doing, I mean, it seemingly, I think, Venu, you start with an examination of Gandhi's thought, but it's really the drama of architecture at one level, which you're introducing here, and you're doing the reverse for architecture, because it's this whole tension of what is the limit of dwelling? What is the limit of dwelling? You know, which is a theme in Heidegger, etc. And then you go back and forth. And it's a very productive way of going back and forth. And I'll come back to that a little later. I'll take up some of the chapters. But now I'd like to open up the floor to my colleagues. Start with any questions.
Venu, this is such exciting work, and you know, so good to see your book in this form. I wanted to make 2 points and to go in the opposite direction from architecture to what is the unstated about Gandhi in your talk. And the references there. And, you know, Gandhi was, you know, extraordinarily influenced by the Isha Upanishad. And so in a sense, that's the theology that is the background of your talk, actually, you know. So the idea of Akash, of ether, of the sky as wholeness, this is coming really from the Isha Upanishad verse 1, you know, and verse 4. And there, you know, the verse one is, you know, about, you know, the Lord inhabiting the universe, Isha Idam. And Idam is about wholeness. It's about the Purna. So I would suggest, actually, I mean, you mentioned nothingness, but it's the Purna, you know, the fullness of the sky, you know. You know, and that is what is, you know, so that the body must not be a barrier to, you know, realizing that particular fullness within yourself. And verse 4 has this reference to the Matarishva, you know, which is the source of all life. Ether, that is, you know, and which is the source of all life. And the idea that Atman, which is Purna, and the importance of achieving that. So I wanted to draw your attention to, you know, these two verses, which I think, you know, is where Gandhi is coming to in that wonderful, wonderful passage that you quoted from Akash. And I'm just wondering also, my question to you is, where is nothingness? Because it didn't seem to me that, you know, you developed the point about nothingness, fullness, you know, that's being talked about much more than nothingness, unless you see the two in some kind of dance, yeah. And also on the architecture of these two dwellings, you know, you refer to how elaborate the second is, but it's actually extremely simple, you know. I mean, it's true, there's a little bit more, but obviously there's this, the living room, which is probably the meeting area, you know, for, you know, so it's a house which is open to people, right? And there's... Mahadev Desai, you mentioned in the, you know, so it's really also the stark simplicity of that, you know, of that. And, you know, there's an ICSR institute in Trivandrum, right, which is designed by Charles. Oh, he refers to it in the book. Okay.
Yes, Laurie Baker. It's in the
that's book. Laurie Baker, yeah. But that's also got, you know, a very similar to, you know, the sense of openness to the sky and so on. Yeah. CDS Trivandrum, yes.
Venu, you want to come in, and questions are welcome in the chat. And, you know, and if you want to speak, I'll try and put your audio on. But questions are welcome, and I will read them out for the audience. So anyone who has a question among the listeners, please send the question in the chat. Venu, you want to come in for this?
I think, like, the question of the house is, I mean, it's yes, it is very simple. I think, like, because I spent so many years actually studying that house, and it's actually, you know, also the low threshold in the house, right? Everything is on the floor, so the windowsill and everything is at a lower level, which also says something about how the sense of oneness with the, you know, with the animals actually which live outside. So there's all of that for sure, but it's also the case that creating partitions inside, it does transform the nature of the relationships between spaces. And I'm saying this purely as, you know, with a little bit of training in architecture, which is at least how we understand when we're actually making plans, that segregation of any kind of functions implies the creation of some kind of a new relationship between those spaces. So, which is, I think, partly the question that I take up in the second chapter in the book, because there, this very question of the difference between a kind of a plan without partitions and a plan with partitions actually turns up in the low-cost housing exhibition, which happens in Delhi in 1954, where people are thinking, how do you reduce the construction cost of a house? Some people are suggesting that you do it by simply not having partition walls inside the house. So you just have a simple dabba, right? Now, there the question of morality comes up. How do parents sleep with children? And all of these other kinds of questions start coming up. And then you also have alternatives where you literally try and introduce small, small functions inside the house. So which means that you will have a bedroom, but you'll have a very small bedroom because you're trying to still cut down on cost in terms of that area. And so these kinds of things, I think it is very simple, no doubt about that. But I'm just saying that in terms of our imagination of it, they point towards two different directions of our conception of household space and the questions of morality and the family that accompany it. So that's and in the first part of the question, the question of nothingness, certainly it's a very difficult question, of course, because when you're talking about the infinite, you're talking about something which is incorporative of everything, which is different from the idea of nothingness, no doubt about that. There is, however, I think in Akash, the currents of the text seem to indicate that there is a kind of a ambiguity between the two, because nothingness is fundamentally tied in with Gandhi's idea of purity. So when he says that if you actually sleep under Akash without actually any partitions between yourself and Akash, you have what he calls dreamless sleep, right? Now this whole idea of dreamlessness is something which is very, strongly tied in with Gandhi's notions of brahmacharya, etc., which keep resurfacing in his writing. And so he's constantly trying to actually give himself this peace. So this becomes one way through which, by exposing oneself to that which is nothing at all, one actually becomes nothing at all insofar as one can actually curb whatever inner sensations one has. So that seems to be one direction in which Akash is going. But on the other side, there is this idea of a kind of a Spinozist conception of the universe as something which is infinite and all, which has no necessity outside it. It is necessary itself, right? And so it's kind of evolving by itself. And that notion of a completeness, of a fullness, if you will, is also there in his writing. So, but I think that there is some strange kind of mixing of concepts over there, which I felt that text is very important, I feel, because it points to at least three different directions. One is this idea of a completeness of the universe. The other is the idea of the emptiness of the universe, or the infinite. And the third is the idea of the finitude of the infinite, which I thought is also a possibility in it. And no doubt, I think the Isha Upanishad is something that I should look into more substantively. Questions.
My Professor Nandi has a question. My colleague Hilal Ahmed has a question. And then we will take, there are some questions in the chat, and I also have a bunch as chair. I have another bunch that will come in later. So, Ashish, you want?
Thanks. Look, I have not read your book, and I cannot get the overall context of your thing. I had to judge from what you were saying, what you were trying to say. If you had met me, or I had met you before you finished the book, I could have given you some examples of people who, without knowing it, were doing innovations of a particular kind, which, according to some, may have fulfilled Gandhi's dreams, and according to others, had nothing to do with it. The reason is this, that any aesthetics is basically an anarchic statement. Any true aesthetics, any attempted aesthetics, which is mode of self-expression, human self-expression, is fundamentally has to be anarchic. And it is no accident that Gandhi's three gurus, all three Westerners, by the way, Tolstoy, Ruskin, and Henry David Thoreau, all three were anarchists. And later on, when he began to read Indian classics and began to say that I'm a Sanatani Hindu, or I am Vedanta, I believe in Vedanta, I need hardly tell you that Vedanta itself is an anarchic text. And amongst the six so-called, what you might call, substantive schools of Indian classical thought, at least three are subtly anarchistic. Vedanta, Tantra, you might reject it as an instrumental form of anarchy. That's a different thing. And Buddhism. These three are definitely so. And one can even argue that Sankhya is also an anarchy. So there is this strand. And Gandhi's clearly and squarely belong to that. He in fact once said that I'm an anarchist. He didn't have in mind the late 19th century European concept of anarchism. But in his hostility to the state and his concept of intervention in the world, he remained anarchic. He believed in Thoreau's statement that a man more right than his neighbor is in the majority of one. That's Thoreau. So there is, if you want that, another kind of justification, it is that. But architecture as a technology and simultaneously an art form has a peculiar tension within it. That if you try to be anarchist in that, it may not make sense to the persons for whom you are building, or the community for whom you are building. And also, if you go only by the community's concept of itself, it may not be architecturally feasible. So there is this peculiar concept of, implicit concept of cosmopolitanism, where you try to reconcile these two things. And you are in fact, when you are entering the sphere of aesthetics, you are partly brushing, close to that. I'm saying this because I have known architects who have tried to build not low-cost housing, not simple houses, who have tried to impose a different concept of simplicity of a different kind, which is, you can call the social concept of simplicity, that he would, according to the need of the client, say it's a school or it's a meeting place, have a concept of what will be done there, which you have to keep in mind to make it acceptable to your the first round of spectators of your work, the users, consumers of that. But they would, like some of this person I'm talking about, if I had met you earlier, I would have told you to have a look from what you say. I think you would have been interested. There is this Gandhi Bhavan in in Tamil Nadu, at built by R.L. Kumar, who was a Bangalorean. He called it artisanal architecture, not vernacular architecture. I was going to come to that. Yes, it's not vernacular, but and it is vernacular automatically. But his thinking is always that he took, went and approached a community which as a community did this architectural work. So this, if you have read dear Nagaraja's work, he used to call them techno communities or techno cultural communities. So he told them, he found such a community. It was not a one standard thing. He different architectural designs came from different kind of communities. So I said, colleague in this community, and they build this Gandhi Bhavan entirely by using stones and pebbles without any serious attempt to bind them together. The sheer weight, it must, you know, stands. Very interesting, doesn't it? ultimately the Gandhi Bhavan chaps were not very comfortable with it. They probably did some changes. Somebody told me that they have tried to make more sure that it doesn't collapse something on their head. But it is very well thought out. This community is an expert in that kind of house. And with the stones he is building, sorry, I'm taking time, you know, that also are pebbles, which are by taken from river bed or some kind of place where the seashore is close to a hill, so that the pebbles are washed and over centuries and does acquire a certain kind of a polish and certain kind of shape, and then to do this with Gandhi Bhavan and that. It's a fantastic achievement, you know. Now, here the architect's choice is important, not all architect's own design. Mm-hmm. I would suggest that there is also a lot of other ways of becoming Gandhian, because I personally think Gandhi would have approved that building. He would have been more uncomfortable in the kind of building in which the this Gandhian Institute in Ahmedabad is located, the university, or even so that's the way it, I'm suggesting to you that there is this other way of looking at it, which is, because architects are always looking for a, whether they like it or not, it's a global science. Whatever you do has the global implications, and that's the way it should go.
Venu, you want to come back on some of the comments? These are a series of comments, actually. You want to come back now, or should I move over? These are.
I'll actually refrain from saying. I'll just say one thing, that I first saw Professor Nandi in the School of Planning and Architecture as a student. So he was actually giving a lecture there, and this is in the 90s. And so I think for me, he is a very long association with architects and architecture. So I'll just leave it at that. I completely appreciate what he's saying.
Okay, now I'll move over to my colleague Hilal Ahmed.
Thank you very much, Venu Bhai. Fascinating. I really enjoyed the text, which I read it by accident, and the lecture which you just gave to us. I haven't read the book, so I do not have, I won't say that I make a claim to make an argument which you are making at the moment. But what I understand from your lecture, the last part of the lecture where you are talking about history, is something which is important. And the two points which I'm going to make are related to that, primarily because I like the way in which you bring in the idea of history and relate it to architecture, etc. So, but that's, as I said, that it has nothing to do with the book. I have to read the book, and I will definitely read the book, and then we'll talk about it. So the first point is that the text which you mentioned in the beginning has got its own history as well. And the context is a political context. So therefore, we have to take that political context into consideration while looking at the tension between two concepts which you invoke. One is merging in the infinity, and second is to restrain from it.
Yeah.
So this tension Gandhi invoked not merely in relation to architecture. I think this tension is visible virtually everything what he does. I'll give you one example of religion. He would say that religion is something which is always imperfect because it comes from human agency, and human agencies are always imperfect. But there, despite that, we have to actually strive for that spiritual moment when, and that's that is all about Sarvadharma Sambhav. So this tension is inextricably linked to the political context. I do not find reference to that political context when it comes to architecture. Now, that poses a question of a different kind. If you compare Nehru's imagination of India and Gandhi's imagination of India, just compare Hind Swaraj with Discovery of India. you find that in Hind Swaraj, the idea of past is always invoked without converting into history. But in case of discovery of India, idea of past, and that too, the built environment, is something which is taken very seriously. Now, that's the reason why for Gandhi, the great monument built by Mughals, etc., he's not interested in them. I think the only reference that comes to my mind is that of 1946-47, when he visited Purana Qila camp, and he said that, look at these great buildings, etc. Muslims are not going to take this with them, etc. But the idea of built environment historically was not central in his imagination. So therefore, we have to keep this factor in mind that to achieve something in future, you need not always rely to the past. So the past is something which is given. He says that in Hind Swaraj very categorically. It happens.
Yeah.
So it happens. So this monument or the great building of the past, or in fact, for that matter, every form of architecture is there. It happens. So therefore, the point I'm trying to make is this, that we need to be sympathetic towards the political context in which Gandhi is making a very powerful point. Not reducing that entirely to the later part of your presentation, where you are comparing two sites where he lived. So that's the first thing. Second thing is about the post-colonial imagination, how Gandhi was appropriated, or Gandhi as a template is used. And I draw, because you use the term architecture again and again, so I draw your attention to Gandhi's samadhi. Vanu Bhutta's design was accepted. But if you carefully look Vanu Bhutta's design of samadhi, it has more element of Nehru's imagination of history,
yes,
rather than Gandhi's.
Yeah.
So I think that when it comes to but despite that, there is one thing which is predominantly central in samadhi, that is the idea of body. Idea of body in that sense is central there. It is located in between the four different arch which will allow the air from go here and there. So the infinity is there, but the idea, the Gandhian idea of body is somehow is I would say monumentalized in samadhi. So the question is that in what ways, architecturally, because you use this grand concept architecture, Gandhi was appropriated in post-colonial India. You must have given answer because I haven't read the book, but I will definitely, but I would like you to briefly comment on that. Thank you very much.
I can respond.
I think you should. This.
Okay. Yeah, I think the final chapter, the afterword in the book is about Rajghat, actually. So it's actually a history of Rajghat and its construction. And without getting into that detail, I think there's an important conceptual kind of an underpinning to the question of finitude and architecture over here. Perhaps Rajghat is a good place to actually ask this question. So what you see is in 1956, when Rajghat is actually being literally constructed. I mean, it's already there, but it's the way in which the discourse around Rajghat and its creation is coming up is that it's about preserving a memory, right? So Rajghat already has a certain kind of a landscape which has emerged, and a lot of people have already visited Rajghat by 1956. So the discourse is that whatever we do over here, it should respect the memories of those who've already been here, right? So already there is a way in which people are trying to kind of freeze and sort of convert what is something that happened into a history. So in the very imagination of that site, you know, even if you have something like B.M. Bhutta's, final scheme that comes up, it appears at the face of it that it's something which is trying to respect the existing, landscape which is already there, which is what is being said in 1956, that the new scheme is actually respecting what's already there. But if you actually look at it, the kind of material that's being used in this new project, it's all about heavy stone, right? Everything is all about like literally memorializing. And even though it looks very horizontal, it still is a very powerful structure, literally in the kinds of material that have been used in it. So there is this attempt at trying to kind of eternalize this early landscape of the samadhi to somehow make it kind of endure in time, right? So there the question of Kenya. So now if you actually try and understand why one mentions finitude, finitude is not just in terms of low cost. Finitude is also about thinking of something that does not last, right? And the politics of the book, really, I mean, if one comes to it, I mean, of course, there's Gandhi's politics and, you know, what was happening there. But the politics of the book is also a kind of a plea against this kind of infinitization of Indian society through architecture and through monumentalization, right? And these hard surfaces that are kind of surfacing everywhere in society, right? And so it's actually trying to say that we have to talk about finitude when the strength of the tradition of 20th century architecture in South Asian societies is finitude. Why is it that we're actually embracing the infinite? You know, I mean, that's the kind of plea at the core of the book. That's the politics of the book. And I think like there's enough evidence of that, you know, be it in terms of monumentalization at a variety of levels, but also the hardening of surfaces, right? Which is a kind of a reference to this desire for the infinite, this desire to outlive, right? Which is not necessarily what the legacy, at least the Gandhian legacy with whatever its problems are, indicates. So I think that's what I wanted to, and as a response to what you're saying. And that's a very valuable question.
Great fun. I'm quite persuaded. The way I also understood finitude as, you know, the kind of perishability and destructibility, as it were, of the built structure that, which is, I mean, perishable. It's going to be destroyed. You conceive it as finite. It won't last long. It doesn't have the endurability that Rajghat has, yeah. But I'm trying to also imagine, as a student of media, his engagement with all kinds of media technologies, as well as, which is also a kind of, technological design in place. Huh? Print, he used, used a lot. And he had a telegraph and all those things, Vardha Ashram especially, right? Mm-hmm. So the houses that you are showing here, at least in the presentation, right, are obviously support your argument. But if we look at his being in the world and his, you know, attempt to connect with the world and through all kinds of media technologies, communications, etc., it is, once again, takes us back to his with the universe, right? With with a huge world that we universe, yeah. Which we can also see as sky, right?
Yeah.
Even the people, huge mass of people, that they can be seen as the sky, right? Mm. And he is using all those technologies. So, do you see also another space, another kind of way in his lifestyle that this tension is produced? This battle between finitude and, you know, kind of infinitude.
It's also performative. It is also absolutely, I think finitude is also performative. That it is, as much as it is a conviction, it's also a performance. That you have to perform this finite. You know, that there is this communication beyond. Absolutely. I think that kind of tension is there always, that everything that he does is representative. I mean, everything that he does is political. So to that extent, whatever is an action that is
You know, two questions from the chat. First is by Ravi Vasudevan, now a colleague whom you know, and Ravi writes, suggested duality of finitude and the infinite especially when framed by Venu in the context of a social imaginary, that is Gandhi on Varnashram. The suggestion appears to be that the household may be the site for such a socially framed and differentiated set of habitations, which is incumbent on the subject to actualize, even as there is a bit to leave it, and the social order. And this is the aporia that I framed at the beginning. This is thus not a strictly conservative disposition and maybe profoundly and productively ambivalent, which is really the project of the book that you're setting up, right? It's deeply ambivalent. It's worth looking at the contemporary popular discourse of bhakti, for example, represented in the same films of studios such as Prabhat, films such as Sant Tukaram 1937, which positions Tukaram at the edge of habitations, urging the importance of caste duty, even as he urges a transcendent site towards which all will ascend. You want to respond, or you?
Yeah, no, I think it's an interesting and difficult conversation, absolutely, because it's productive, but at the same time, I think it's very much informed by that moment of the conversation with Dr. Ambedkar. I mean, you keep seeing references to Dr. Ambedkar repeatedly in the archive at that time. And this adherence to staying within what is supposedly, you know, accorded to you is also a response. It's a conversation, you know? And I think, like, I feel that that's something which informs this architecture. Number one, so it's not as if like this architecture pre-exists, you know, this conversation with Dr. Ambedkar. I feel that like the emphasis on limits is actually getting more and more heightened at this time, principally because there is a desire to step beyond limits. You know, where Dr. Ambedkar is making his speech. I mean, he's actually writing his speech, and it's about the boundedness of a certain identity which he's actually writing against. So I think there is that kind of very difficult conversation going on. And I feel somewhere that everything that is happening in Shegaon in 1936 is very much like fraught with this sense of like, you know, how to stay, you know, when there is every incentive to leave. And Gandhi himself falls very ill at this time. I mean, it's twice, like 1935, late 35, he has a big massive nervous breakdown. He has blood pressure issues in any case. And then he goes to Nandi Hill, and from there he comes and actually takes up residence in Adi Nivas. And then following that, within a month or so, he's down with malaria. And they literally construct a road from Shegaon till Wardha just to get him to the hospital, right? So and that's when he kind of writes his very strong piece about how he'd much rather die staying in this hut rather than leave, right? And so I think what you're seeing is certainly this very strong urge to actually stay at whatever cost. And so that's where I felt that like that, yes, it is a very strange and difficult conversation between caste identity as much as also, you know, this kind of commitment to sort of staying in one's proper place or where one should properly be. And there's also, by the way, the time when he's actually left the Congress. So there's this whole other side to how he's completely starting a new chapter in his life, where he's actually renounced, you know, he's actually, the Congress meeting has happened long ago, and he's right now on he's completely in uncharted territory. I don't know if that fully answers the question, but, you know, I think as much as one would like to see this as a productive ambiguity, one is also uncomfortable with it, precisely because there is a strong emphasis on hierarchical systems over here, which is Varnashram Dharma. So I think that is something to also be aware of. But yes, I think like you can't separate these two from each other. As much as you would like to take what is meaningful about this idea of finitude, one also is aware that it actually can take us in directions which are conceivably, you know, not only problematic, but have very difficult implications. But that's the kind of tension I've been trying to struggle with in this book. To actually not to be, to keep everything in front of me, to not actually let go of what seems to be meaningful and what seems to be going in, what seems to.
Venu, I will read out the other questions. There is one comment by Venugopal on, he says, house types and plans evolved in response to climate, culture, material availability and construction techniques, and of course, social context. And he says this significantly impacts the character of dwelling spaces. Mm-hmm. Then there's one by Shakib which says Gandhi played with finitude in all domains of life, politics, sexuality, culture. Please comment. Now this is a big question. then we have a clarification by Pratap Chandra Bhaira, who says that cost was decided beforehand, which you've referred to, the 100 rupee cost of the heart. So how did cost shape the design? Or there was a plan, and did the plan incorporate these elements? Then finally, Ankur, who is asking, thanks for your talk, Professor Madhipatti. You have mentioned the materiality of Gandhi's body with reference to finitude and his political action. But when you talk about the architecture of the house, you make it entirely an economic argument of being a low cost, unless I miss something. I'm wondering about the relationship of architectural space as the extension of his body and your intriguing use of the word, and he quotes, phenomenon.
Well, many questions. I'd very quickly say that, yes, the cost is something which is decided in beforehand. But if you actually look at the archive, the discourse is about how the shape of Adinivas emerges principally through the act of foregoing. So once the cost is decided, it seems that, okay, in housing, when we talk about housing, there's something called minimum standards. There's a whole history to that. I think the book actually tries to talk about that as well. That there is such a thing as a minimum standard that, you know, at various times, there are different definitions of what this minimum standard is. And Gandhi is intensely aware of this idea of a minimum standard, because just before he comes to Shegaon in 1936, he actually goes to Bangalore. And first he goes to the Kolar gold fields and mine fields. And then he actually comes to Bangalore and he speaks against the housing conditions of those who are working in the Kolar mine fields. And he's basically saying that there should be a minimum standard for housing. And if you're making so much money out of the work of these people who are actually doing the mining work, then as the owners of the mines, you owe it to the workers to actually provide them with certain basic minimum housing standards. And not surprisingly, the moment he actually comes into, he's talking about shifting into Shegaon, he's asking for a house and he's asking for a minimum standard. So he actually defines what he identifies as a minimum standard. Now, minimum standards and maximum limits, they're totally different things, right? When he's putting a housing limit, when he's actually talking about, you know, not over exceeding 100 rupees, that's one thing. On the other side is the idea that whatever it is you make, there should be a basic bottom line, that this much should be there, right? So I think it's very important to recognize that both concepts actually work together. The idea of a minimum standard and the idea of a maximum limit. And of course, there's a long history to this idea of both, the minimum standard and maximum limit, and I'm not getting into that. But I'm just saying that cost, especially in terms of living conditions, is a very fraught concept. So that's where I'll leave that answer. And maybe for better understanding, I think some portions of the book might be helpful. I do try and describe that in detail. So finally, after having decided a minimum standard, when he actually starts seeing the cost escalate, he starts doing away with functions in the house. So he says, do away with partitions, do away with a hut, separate hut for Mahadev Desai. So that's the way you actually end up with this very pared down minimal thing in the end, as something which he had to finally live with, because that's as much as he could have, you know, achieved with 100 rupees, something to that effect. And you can see the archive and you can see the book also. It extensively talks about this. The idea of the cost and the economic argument. Well, I think it's the other way around. What is central to the book, or even the descriptions I'm trying to give, is not the economic cost. The idea is of finitude. It just so happens that the vocabulary of finitude manifests itself in Gandhi's words in reference to economic expenditure. But the idea is not that I'm beginning, I mean, it's called low cost, but the idea of the book is not about low cost, actually. It's about finitude. And it just so happens that the only available recognizable or legible architectural language that we have to talk about finitude is logos, right? Which is not to say that finitude exhausts itself in low-cost thinking itself, right? And so my point is that Gandhi is putting limits on virtually everything. It just so happens that housing expenditure is another one of those things where he's actually putting a limit. But this raises the deeper question, how do we talk about finitude, right? Not only in the field of, in Gandhi's ideas, but also in architecture, what is finitude? Does finitude restrict itself to our comprehension of, let's say, budgetary limits, right? Are there other ways of imagining finitude, right? I mean, so that's a kind of a set of questions which I think the book tries to get into. If you read the final chapter, the conception of what are limits is not necessarily Gandhian. It comes from a very different location. The final chapter, which is on a community called the Kolam Samaj in this village, Bagdara. The idea of the limit over there is fundamentally coming from people who speak a certain language, which is the Kolami Bhasha. So there, the idea of finitude is coming partly from a linguistic identity, and partly it is coming also from a desire to actually, from a perspective of environmental ethics, which is that the desire to actually, stop environmental pollution in and around the village on account of the emergence of a certain industrial unit over there. So I think that kind of the idea of finitude is at the core of this. Finitude in terms of budget and low-cost housing comes up as a moment, but it also is not restricted to it, is what I'd say.
Thank you, Abeno. I have one or two questions, which I think you raised in your book, but I think it'd be very nice if you can expand on that for the audience. One is this this whole tension that, it's a big debate that happened, and in the lovely chapter that you have on Korea, you open up some of these questions, where you have someone who's clearly coming from a modernist tradition, but he's uncomfortable in that tradition. He's not fully comfortable trying to engage with this notion of an appropriate dwelling. And that really doesn't work. It doesn't work. It's a kind of, and you engage with that space very, very well. So I would like you to talk a bit about this encounter of the modernist tradition with what they regard as Gandhian architecture, as the appropriate post-colonial Gandhian architecture, right? That's one. The second question, which is, I think, still important, is, which was an older debate, but it seems to have completely gone out of, one was the idea of justice. Architectural, housing justice, which is, so this is crucial because the earlier critique of modernism, of modernist critiques and older Marxist critiques of vernacular architecture was precisely this. This cannot offer appropriate justice. It's not an adequate solution, right? So you've dealt with that. You've dealt with a little bit in the book. But I think the question of justice is still relevant. Yeah. How can an architecture of limits address the question of justice, because the hardening of, hardening of architecture, which is all the spectacular architecture that is very popular now today, both in a particular version of star architects and national regimes, right? So we need to address these questions. So I would like you to first talk about your Korea chapter, because that's a phase that is now behind us, and address this new contemporary moment. Which, more materially, which you did quite wonderfully in that chapter. The politics of justice.
I think Korea comes across, I think for the better part, the kind of Korea that we all know is the supremely confident individual, who speaks with a lot of flair. And I mean, as indeed was the Korea that I saw as a student in college, right? This person who knows exactly what he's talking about and is, really articulate and clearly somebody who's a person about the world, and I think But it's just that, like, what in this chapter, you know, where I'm trying to write about him, I mean, it's just that the archival sources, you know, they seem to point towards a slightly different picture. That this is a person who actually is advocating low-rise, medium to high-density dwelling in Mumbai, and in Navi Mumbai, as it turns out, in the 70s. And there's a long history to Korea's involvement with, you know, the plan over there. And not getting into the depths of that, but just to simply point out that he seems to be saying that, you know, high-rise housing is not something which we should pursue because there's a lot of inflated value to high-rise housing, and it's all very developer-driven. Rather than that, we should actually think of, like, you know, some kind of horizontal spread of housing where there is a more equitable distribution of space, right? So in his idea, in his understanding, you know, Indian cities have basically been, you know, they've emerged as very unequal because there is this, you know, the distribution of space and land has not been, you know, commensurate to the kinds of, like, needs of people. And so to that extent, I think he's very much a very sensitive thinker of space, where he understands how space is shared, how space is used collectively, right? These are some of the strengths of Korea's thinking as an architect. And I think you'll see this not only in his own formal projects, but a lot of his writing talks about this. But that being said, it makes sense then for him to actually promote something that looks like a medium to high density, low rise pattern of habitation, because he believes that society and social living is served better when people actually live in what you would call some kind of a face-to-face relationship, right? And so this idea of face-to-face is fundamentally very central to the idea, in a Gandhian sense, if you will, of living in low-rise, medium to high-density housing. We actually get to see people. We actually live in the midst of life, in the midst of community, right? As opposed to simply living in high-rise housing. Right now, I'm living on the sixth floor. So much for Gandhian housing. But that being said, I'm just saying that, like, you meet people at the elevator, right? And the idea is that that there is a kind of the absence of a face-to-face community, right? So he's actually talking about how, if we were to organically begin with this idea of a face-to-face community, what is the kind of pattern or morphology that organically emerges on account of that? And that he identifies as this kind of low-rise Gandhian pattern of living, which is what he calls an urban analog to Gandhi's quote-unquote village utopia, right? Now, that's all very fine. I mean, that's what he seems to suggest. But he's also of the impression that India is going to become economically very strong. So this is in the 1970s, right? So he's actually, everything is in kind of in preparation for this moment of economic prosperity that's going to come. So his whole idea is that let's endure with what we're seeing in the present. And in 20 years' time, there's going to be a lot of wealth that's going to come in. And that wealth will transform and lead us to a wholly new kind of world of architectural development, right? Now, what's interesting is, however, in the same time, around 1976, he gives an interview in Vancouver, where he goes for an international conference in settlements, right? And there he suggests that somebody asks him, what do you think is the pattern of life that you see in the South, the global South, perhaps, in the year 2000? And the answer there is very intriguing. He again says in 2000, we'll have a lot of horizontal low-rise housing, as if we're going to have, like, some kind of squatter settlements, almost like a Gandhian pattern of living, where with a dense spread of, you know, human communities sort of, you know, kind of distributed over tracts of land, right? So again, the question is of distribution. So for him, justice in terms of distribution remains a going concern, even in his conception of the future. That's the first part of a response to Ravi. Actually, it's combining both questions together. The second thing is that it's also the case that he's not able to think beyond the Gandhian present, right? He's not even though he's talking about a time when money is going to come into Indian society, he's still not able to imagine what that world will look like. He's not able to prescribe anything but a Gandhian, in his own mind, a quote-unquote Gandhian pattern of urban living, right? So there is a way in which he is very careful, or at least there's this trepidation where he's not really comfortable with thinking beyond a certain time frame. And I think that's also a very strong notion of presentism, which I think is there in a lot of Gandhian thinking. It's not as if Korea is a card-carrying Gandhian, no way. That's not what I'm trying to say. I'm just saying that the moment he invokes Gandhi, he's already in the process committing himself to the present as something that is an inescapable horizon for his thinking, right? And I think that's something which kind of begins to surface in his writing and his thinking. And that's why I'm saying he appears very certain about the future when he speaks. But then if you actually probe a little into it, you realize that this is almost like it's a sort of a clinging to the present, you know, which is almost like he's not able to think past that with any degree of confidence, which is not necessarily a bad thing, I would say. So I think that's the larger question that you see with Korea. It's a very interesting thinker who's actually fundamentally a finite thinker to that extent. You know, he's not thinking beyond finitude, and he doesn't probably see much of a point in thinking beyond finitude. And to that extent, I think he is slightly different in his emphasis on things from the modernists. Because the modernists are mostly, I mean, he is a modernist, but the modernists are also fundamentally thinking of the infinite. I mean, the idea is of eternity, right? I mean, when we're raising these massive hard edifices, fundamental to the creation of those entities is a striking belief in their permanence, right? It's another thing that they don't look permanent anymore. I mean, Chandigarh is, you know, I mean, all sorts of things, the buildings weather, right? Buildings fall apart. But the point is that the intentionality behind the creation of a certain kind of built world is one that is looking at forever, right? Whatever forever is. And so that is where I think Korea is slightly different, where he's not as much into hard surfaces, but it is in the geometry where this element of hard surface, hard planes and all starts coming in. And there, there's a slightly different story, which I think I'll hold back because I'll take more questions.
I think Venu, we've fulfilled all the questions. I want to thank you for a really nice session. And I would encourage everyone who's listening in and who will listen and see this video, please buy the book. It's a wonderful read, extremely carefully crafted, and offers food for thought in our times. So best of luck, and we hope to see more of you and hear and read more of you. Thank you, Venu.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks.